Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of the Education, Children and Young People. First item on our agenda today is to take evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, John Swinney, MSP, and his officials on the redress for survivors, historical child abuse and care, reconsideration and review of determinations, Scotland Regulations 2022. So I'd like to welcome the Deputy First Minister to the committee this morning. Good morning, Mr. Swinney. The Deputy First Minister is accompanied by Paul Beaton, Legislation and Contributions Unit Head, Scottish Government, Claire Montgomery, Solicitor, Scottish Government Legal Directorate. So good morning to both of you as well. Mr. Swinney, can I invite you to first speak to the draft instrument?
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful for the opportunity to discuss this issue with the committee this morning to explain the detail of the affirmative instrument before the committee. As the committee will be aware, we passed a significant milestone at the end of last year with the launch of Scotland's redress scheme, which opened for applications on the 8th of December. I'm pleased to inform the committee that we have received more than 2,000 calls to the scheme since its launch, and over 250 application forms have been received. This represents a significant step towards facing up to the wrongs of the past and the harm caused to society's most vulnerable children. As we move to deliver redress to survivors, we must ensure the scheme operates fairly for all. Part of that is providing mechanisms to be able to reconsider and deal with determinations under the scheme made in error, including those relating to the outcome of a redress application. That clear goal is what the draft regulations before the committee today seek to achieve. Section 75 of the Redress for Survivors Historical Child Abuse and Care Scotland Act 2021 creates a reconsideration process whereby a Redress Scotland panel can revisit a determination already made under Part 4 of the Act should a concern arise that it was materially affected by error. This includes where there was a potential mistake made in making the determination, or where it is thought that a determination was made on the basis of incorrect or misleading information. Where the panel determines that an error has occurred, it must put that right. Importantly, where an applicant is not satisfied when they are told the outcome of a determination, they can request a review. Safeguards are included within the Act so that when the review is linked to the determination of a redress application, an applicant cannot be prejudiced by exercising their review right. In practice, we hope and anticipate that we will very rarely require to use these reconsideration and review processes, as robust measures have been embedded throughout the application process and wider scheme to reduce the opportunity for error and potential fraud. However, these draft regulations aim to ensure that we have suitable mechanisms in place to support people through the reconsideration and review processes if required. They also allow us to respond in a fair and effective manner to all possible outcomes of these processes linked to the determination of a redress application. Whilst the range of possible outcomes is complex, the principle underpinning the proposed amendments to the Act is simple. As far as possible, we wish to put an applicant back in the position they would have been had an error not occurred. This may mean that an applicant is offered a different redress payment than the sum they have been offered or have accepted previously, or they may benefit from a fresh offer where an error has led to them not being given one before. In these scenarios, we intend that they will be given the option to do what's right for them with the benefit of legal advice by either accepting or rejecting the new offer. The waiver is a key and much debated aspect of the Act. It is essential that the way in which it operates is fair. These draft regulations therefore seek to amend Section 46 of the Act on waiver. The effect of the proposed amendments is that where an applicant is issued with an updated or fresh offer of a redress payment following a reconsideration or review, the waiver linked to that offer will reflect the contributor list at the time the offer should have been made rather than the date of the offer itself. This will ensure that where the offer is accepted, survivors do not miss out on any opportunity they would otherwise have had to raise civil proceedings. Where a person has already signed a waiver to accept a redress payment offer, which changes following the reconsideration or review process, we consider that it is only fair that they have the opportunity to reconsider this choice and receive legal advice at this critical stage in the process. We have therefore made provision for this and ensured that if a person is content to accept a new offer, the waiver signed to accept their original offer will remain in place. If they decide that accepting the new offer is not the right option for them, they will be able to reject it, and any waiver signed to accept the original offer will be rendered of no effect. In the interest of fairness, we have also made provision for a waiver to be rendered of no effect where it is determined that a person ought not to have been offered an award under the scheme. As I have stressed, these draft regulations ensure that people have access to support and advice, along with the provision for the payment of legal fees and reimbursement of costs and expenses, allowing them to fully understand and engage with the reconsideration and review processes and to make the choices that are right for them. This is the final draft instrument in a package for implementation of the redress scheme, and I welcome and appreciate the cross-party support that has ensured that we have delivered the scheme that survivors deserve. I hope that I have provided members with a sufficient overview of the draft instrument, and my officials and I welcome any questions that the committee may have.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Can I ask if any members have any questions or comments on the draft instrument? You may indicate in the chat box. Deputy First Minister, you rightly put great emphasis in the statement you've just given us on fairness. In terms of the principles of fairness, at each point in the process, will the person at the centre of the process, which clearly is claimant, will they have guidance, will they have legal advice, and will that be funded?
There will be guidance, convener, that goes with the instruments that I've set out today, and that we work through. I should acknowledge at the outset that this is a complex instrument. The reason for its complexity is that there are multiple permutations that have to be provided for to establish legal clarity, hence the complexity. And I've looked at this issue very carefully with my officials, and there is just no easy way around about it. So guidance has to accompany the instrument, but in relation to any judgments that a survivor is making, they will be supported by having access to legal advice at any point. It's been a crucial element of the redress scheme in its entire design that all applicants must be able to make informed judgments about what is the right course of action for them to take. That must be funded, and there is a schedule within the instrument which sets out the arrangements for meeting the cost of legal advice where that should be required by applicants.
And in the case, and we hope, obviously, as you said, that there are very few examples of this at all, but in the case where there is any suggestion of fraud, that the legal advice for the individual concerned would still be part of the funded package of support that they would get through this process. Is that right?
That is correct, because we have to be, obviously, the consideration of what has led to the circumstances which have given rise to a reconsideration must ensure that individuals are supported without prejudice in that process. So a conclusion that fraud has perhaps occurred is a conclusion. It is not a starting point to the process. So individuals have to have the access to the necessary advice to support them in that process.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. That's as you say, it's a very complex situation with many permutations, but I think you've been very clear in your answers around the principles of fairness being upheld at all points in the process, as far as the individuals at the centre of the process are concerned. Do any other colleagues have questions for the Deputy First Minister? I think not. So thank you. I thank you, Deputy First Minister. We will now move on to agenda item 2. Our next item of business is to invite the Deputy First Minister to move motion S6M02797 that the Education, Children and Young People Committee recommends that the Redress for Survivors, Historical Child Abuse and Care, Reconsideration and Review of Determinations Scotland Regulations 2022 be approved. I would invite the Deputy First Minister to speak to and move the motion.
Convener, I move the motion that stands in my name, and the comments that I've placed on the record already are adequate contribution to the explanation of the order. So I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Do members have any comments? The question is that motion S6M02797 in the name of John Swinney be approved. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. The committee must now produce its report on this draft instrument. Is the committee content to delegate responsibility to the Deputy Convener and I to agree this report on behalf of the committee? Are we agreed? We are agreed. I would like to thank John Swinney, the Deputy First Minister, and his officials for their attendance today. Thank you very much. Pause briefly before we move on to agenda item 3. Our third item of business is the consideration of subordinate legislation, the Nutritional Requirements for Food and Drink in Schools, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. Do members have any comments on this instrument? Well, and maybe I can start off by saying that I have questions about this instrument. I have specific concerns about any legislative regulation that involves reducing the requirement to maintain nutritional standards in the food that we serve to children in school. The 2020 regulations are designed to keep salt, sugar, fat and saturated fats in food and drink that's provided in schools to an appropriate level. And when we have a regulation, which is now in effect, because this is a negative instrument, that means that ministers already enacted this regulation. The questions I have are, why at this stage in the pandemic, why is this regulation now being brought forward? Have there been examples where this regulation has been applied in schools in Scotland since it was enacted in December? What's the reporting method for this? How long will this regulation be in place? And on what basis will it be removed? If there's no date at which it expires, which there isn't, at what point will it be removed? Because clearly, I don't think anyone wants to see this particular amendment to this regulation on nutritional value of the food that we're serving in schools. I don't think we want to see that perpetuated longer than is necessary, and if it's necessary at all, and I'm not entirely clear why it's felt to be necessary at this point in time. Those are the questions I've got. Now, there is nobody here to answer those questions. And I'm going to bring in Willie Rennie because he wants to add some words. Willie Rennie.
Yeah, no, I agree with all the questions you've got. And in fact, all the papers that we've received, convener, there's no explanation for why this is required. We've seen some of the media reports about how some councils have found it difficult to get supplies of the right quality, but we don't know how widespread that is. Is it ongoing? Why is it the case? This original regulation was introduced in April, which was quite a significant time after the start of leaving the European Union and also well into the pandemic. So I'm puzzled as to why this is required. But also so soon after the order was brought in the first place, why was a kind of an escape chute, if I want to put it that way, from providing the standard? Why was that not considered as part of the regulation in the first place? Why has it been brought in now? So there's issues around timing and so on. and just the explanation as to why it's necessary. So I just think we should try and get those explanations from the Minister before we proceed.
Thank you, Willie Rennie. I think there are quite a lot of questions that arise in relation to this, and what we will do as a result of this conversation, this part of our meeting, and the comments that both Willie Rennie and I have made, is we will, with the agreement of the committee, have the clerks send a letter to the relevant minister seeking an understanding as to what the answers to our questions are, so that we can bring this back and give it further consideration. I hope that's agreeable to colleagues. Fergus Ewan.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I mean, I think it's perfectly reasonable to ask for more information, and so, you know, I've no objection to that. When we're asking for that further information, Convener, I wonder if we could add to that request a request that we get an update as to the progress that is being made and the current status and take up of the Food for Life programme, which involves councils receiving assistance in order to, if you like, support local purchasing of food locally with local supply chains. And I think the Soil Association are involved with this, and I had former involvement with it from time to time and visited, for example, East Ayrshire, which is seen as a leader in this regard, but also Highland Council, where, you know, they do things like purchase food from a local butcher, which serves hundreds of schools. And these things aren't difficult, aren't easy to do, but something that we all support, namely the purchase of local food rather than, you know, buying chickens from Thailand or whatever. So if we're going to ask for information, I wonder if we could ask for information about this, because I understand that most of the 32 local authorities, certainly over half, are subscribers to this programme, but some aren't. So it would be useful to get an update on what has been, Convener, and I know this will be close to your heart, a Scottish Government good news story.
Thank you. Thank you, Fergus. I'm all for good news, as you and this is simply a butcher and the grandson of a small farmer. I'm all for this idea of local sourcing of food. And we have discussed in the past, informally, the nature and the quality of the food that we're serving in school dinners in Scotland schools. So I very much welcome your comments. I'm going to bring in Bob Doris.
Just very briefly, Convener, I think the line of questioning yourself from Willie Rennie is absolutely justified, and just draw members' attention just to one line in the papers we have for today's meeting, which says from the government, this amendment is intended to be temporary response to specific circumstances, and ministers intend to revoke it as soon as circumstances allow. That's precisely what we need more information and clarity on. So if that can be dealt with in correspondence, that would be ideal.
Yeah, thank you. That's that does crystallise the concerns that we've been expressing. Thank you for that, Bob Doris. So at this point, with the committee's agreement, we will have that letter sent to ministers, and we'll share the contents of the reply that we get. I think everyone's agreed. Thank you. And on that basis, I wish to move on to agenda item 4, which is the evidence session that we have organised for today on drink and needle biking. And joining us today for a roundtable discussion is Jill Stevenson, the Diversity and Inclusion and Director of Student Services at the University of Stirling, and the Director of Association of Managers of Student Services in Higher Education; Ellen McRae, President of the Edinburgh University Students Association; Martha Williams, Girls Night In of the Girls Night In campaign; Mike Grieve, who is Chair of the Nighttime Industries Association. Looking for Mike on my screen. I'm sure he's there somewhere. Oh, there he is. Superintendent Hilary Sloan, Partnerships Prevention and Community Wellbeing, Harm Prevention, Police Scotland; Andrew Green, Policy Manager, Pub Operations, the Scottish Beer and Pub Association; Professor Sally Mapstone, Principal and Vice-Chancellor of the University of St Andrews and Vice-Convener of University of Scotland, and Kate Wallace, who is Chief Executive Officer of Victim Support Scotland. Thank you for your time today. A bit of housekeeping to begin. Our session is intended to be a virtual round table. We've all been working on screens long enough to know some of the challenges that that might present. In order for us to have the conventional round table and the dynamic of conversation around the table that we would normally have. And so it's intended that we'll be conversational rather than a question and answer sessions. And as I can't see everybody on the screen at any one time, please put an R in the chat box. I will come straight to you. Please do not wait to be asked to say anything, to want to say something. We want to hear from you, and we want to hear you talk to each other. So I'll be monitoring the chat box. I'll make sure that everyone who wants to speak is brought in. If I can start our discussion, the number of reported crimes under the two relevant offences that we're talking about is increased significantly, particularly in quarter four last year. What do the panel think in terms of these offences? I mean, have they risen significantly in 2021? Why has there been a spike, no pun intended, in the reported instances of these crimes? Who would like to go first? I mean, maybe Superintendent Hilary Sloan. Hilary, would you like to start us off on that?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Obviously, as you've said, there was a significant increase in reporting of spiking incidents mid-October, which coincided with public concern in relation to the wider piece regarding violence against women and girls. And that is where we have seen the increase. The reporting spiked around the Halloween weekend. But what I am really pleased to say is that since then, it has been on the downward trajectory. So that's really good news from a Police Scotland perspective. And probably what I would say, what has been key to that, I'm hoping, is the work that we've been doing in partnership with various organisations, some of which are represented around the table today, to share communications messages, to provide that consistent message to all, and to provide that public reassurance to the public that they should have the confidence to report incidents to Police Scotland.
And what's your assessment as to what caused that uptick over the Halloween period? Was it in one specific geographic area? Was it one set of events? What was it?
So the three primary areas where the incidents have been most prevalent are in the student cities, Aberdeen, Glasgow and Edinburgh. And it usually coincides with the start of Fresher Week. We usually see an increase round about that time. But as you've highlighted, Convener, clearly there was a significant increase this week around about Halloween. And again, that was, I think, due to other issues that were prevalent within social media. But again, linking in with the universities and members of the people that are around the room today to really understand what the issues were, to get a clear picture of what was happening, and then to share that consistent message amongst all of us to just ensure that we were providing that support that was required for particularly that student population.
Thank you. Sally.
Hello, thank you. I agree with Hilary that there's still a lot of work to be done to gauge the extent and the prevalence of spiking in Scotland. And I think that's one of the issues we might discuss today. How best can we work with young people to ensure that we actually do get that information and can use it properly? I think it is relevant to say that this is obviously a matter that particularly affects young people, and that includes students, but we shouldn't think that this is something that is exclusively confined to the student community, and that's perhaps an important point to register, that spiking as a problem is more widespread than in our universities and colleges and in the towns associated with them. There is no doubt, obviously, that it can be associated with the start of term and young people getting together. I think that's true. But I think that Hilary makes a really important point in stressing the progress that we have made in getting evidence, in working with our young people and with our students to get out there the kind of information, both about how to deal with a situation in which you may think you've been spiked, but also to prevent it and to generate that culture of support. And a further point I'd like to make in relation to that is that prevention should very much be in relation to the perpetrators, and that it really is important that we listen to students in this context and that we don't get into the culture of victim blaming, which really isn't appropriate and doesn't help young people.
Thanks, Sally. Let's hear the voice of the students. Ellen.
Thank you very much. I firstly want to start off by really agreeing with Sally's point around it's obviously not just students who are impacted by this, yet I think it's true that every young person and student knows at least one other person who's been spiked during a night out. And within the student community, this doesn't actually feel like an uncommon occurrence, yet that doesn't make it any less frightening, of course. I think there's issues presented with reporting, and that's why kind of knowing if there's been an increase in spiking incidents or whether kind of more people are just coming forwards, I think comes down to a challenge of young people knowing how to report things. I think there is a challenge when women and other young people want to come forward, but they don't know whether they'll be believed or taken seriously. But also there are a variety of different reporting systems which may feel unclear. It's not certain whether, I feel like quite a lot of young people don't know whether they should go to the police or to their university or to their students' association. And understandably, it can be a very emotionally burdensome process. So minimising the number of times that a young person would have to talk about this is obviously our goal. But for example, our students' association's advice place since September 2021 has had 5 drink spiking and 2 suspected injection spiking inquiries, but we know there's been a lot more than that reported within the City of Edinburgh at the moment. So I think there is a real issue in terms of trying to understand the scale of the picture due to the level of reporting. And I'd also want to add there is a capacity issue within university systems who are currently struggling to handle the volume of gender-based violence reports that come on campus and that happen within the city, and they're most definitely linked with, some cases are obviously linked with incidences of spiking also, but I'll pause there.
Well, thanks, Alan. Let's bring in Martha from Girls Might In campaign. Martha.
Hi, good morning, everyone. I just wanted to give another student perspective on one of the initial points, which was why now has spiking escalated? And I think that an explanation that I've come to is that obviously the pandemic has been keeping us all indoors for years now. And this beginning of term was, it reflected the first time that people have been able to come out again and, you know, experience nightclub culture. And I think that with the spiking by injection claims, because those were so severe, they were taken more seriously by authorities, but they encouraged other victims of spiking to come forward after they had seen that it was becoming something that was being paid attention to. So I think that spiking has always been a prevalent issue. I think that the pandemic has obviously prevented it from happening for a few years because those environments haven't been facilitated. But yeah, my analysis is that once authorities showed that they were interested in spiking and that they were curious into these incidents of injection spiking, then all of the other victims then felt as though their stories mattered and that they could come forward. And then just to go back to another point, In recent statistics that were gathered by a social media spike report over the past month, it was reported that only 36% of people who believed that they had been spiked reported it to the police, and only 62% of those submitters reported the spiking incident to the venue. And so it is still being massively underreported. And so obviously there's only so much that the police and the authorities can do if they're not, you know, gathering these reports.
What's the reason for that, Martha?
I think that there is such a culture, as Alan was saying, of victim blaming, and people are afraid that if they come forward, then their story won't be taken seriously. And unfortunately, there's a lot of shame that is associated with sexual assault and things of this nature. And so I think that it just comes from a place of fear and, you know, years of oppression of women and people not taking sexual assault seriously. And so I think that one of the main concerns should be changing that focus. Or changing that kind of stigma and really encouraging people to come forward and show that if they do come forward, they'll be supported instead of shamed.
Mm-hmm. And Stephanie Callahan's put a note in the chat function here to ask you a little bit more about the data from that survey you mentioned. Can you just run through that 36% that reported? How did they go about reporting?
So this data was gathered from a social media account that has made themselves kind of an outlet for people to come forward and report incidents of spiking that they think they've experienced. And so it doesn't represent all of the spiking incidents that have taken place in general, just those that the social media account has gathered. And so the 36% from this last month reported it to the police. I'm not exactly sure of the process that they use to do that, but those are just self-reports. And then the 60% of submitters that reported it to the venue, I'm guessing that that would mean they reached out to, you know, staff at the venue either through social media or calling them. So I'm not exactly sure of the specifics of how people have gone about reporting these incidents, but that's kind of what I've gathered.
Let's turn to Kate Wallace. You might be able to add some further light.
Hi there. Thank you for that, and thanks for convener for bringing me in. Yeah, the underreporting of crime generally is an issue. It is about less than half of people who report crime to the police than say that they've been a victim of crime. So I think Martha's figures will not be too far away. We know that underreporting of spiking is generally an issue, and that is through, you asked about why that is, fear of not being believed, fear of and lack of understanding, as a previous speaker mentioned, about the process. Actually not 100% being sure yourself whether that's happened either. And fear about being re-traumatised through the whole criminal justice process is a concern for many people who found themselves potentially in that situation. Ourselves and Rape Crisis have been asking around pathways for people who suspect that they've been spiked to be able to get access to health screening and testing so that they can find that out without going forward to the police. And we raised that in some other roundtables that have been held, and we haven't had an answer back on that as far as I know, but I think that certainly would help being able to access testing to find out whether you actually have been spiked. So yeah, I think there is a culture of underreporting around spiking anyway, and I think that a couple of things I wanted to say. I agree completely with Sally, this is not just a student issue. Ourselves in Rape Crisis certainly see that in terms of the calls that we get to our helplines. But also the prevention and moving away from a feeling of victim blaming, that it's all on victims to prevent the situation, keep themselves safe. That culture absolutely has to be shifted, and is something that Hilary mentioned too. So yeah, I think that another thing to say is that spiking. Yeah, we saw a pretty unusual situation cropping up and at the back end of October around spiking by injection. But by far the most prevalent method of spiking is additional unwanted alcohol. So I think it's important to remember that. And also, as we start to move out of the kind of pandemic and the unusual situation that we've had around lockdowns and the rest of it, home parties are an issue as well. And so we've been seeing quite a different picture over the last couple of years. But ordinarily, we would see spiking with additional alcohol as being the most prevalent, and house parties being an area of concern for people as well. But I think, given as many support pathways, given victims who suspect that they've been spiked, access to testing to find out if they actually have been without necessarily needing to report to the police, and making sure that there's as many referral pathways as possible in place so that people can access support and help for us as the way forward. And remember as well, there's no specific crime is spiking either, so that doesn't help in terms of gauging prevalence either. Sorry, convener, to interrupt.
No, that's an that's a very important point you've just raised. You mentioned the settings in which that, you know, basically you described it as additional and welcome alcohol. I presume people putting alcohol into soft drinks and such like.
Or giving you over trickles when you don't want that, when you've not asked for that.
And what's the setting? What's the most likely setting for that? Did you suggest there it was more in a private setting or in?
Well, it's multiple, but I think and it's not just one or the other. I suppose what I was wanting to do was to make sure that people remember that spiking can occur out with nightclubs and pubs in the nighttime economy. That spiking is an issue in private residences too. So it's not an either or, and it's not a more of or less of. It's that is something that can happen, and that people need to be aware of, and that, as Sally says, we need to be addressing the perpetrators directly. That is not acceptable, and Scotland's not a country where we see that as an acceptable behaviour.
Mm-hmm. Going to back in, Hilary. Hilary?
Thanks, convener. Probably just to reiterate some of the points that have been made already. We and Police Scotland have focused our communications on perpetrator behaviour. It is them that we need to communicate with, and not with the victims. We are a victim-centred organisation, and we have been completely victim-focused from the very start in relation to this issue. What I would say as well is that partnership, working in collaboration with all the blue light services and the people that are represented around the table today, has been absolutely key for us to share that communications toolkit that we pull together. We shared that with all the partners around the table. We have made sure that the messaging is consistent and really encouraging people to report instances to us. Ideally, we want people to be confident to report matters to us, whether it's the day after or in a week's time. We want them to be confident in Police Scotland to report those incidents to us. And I think from the collaboration work that we have done with the partners, that has really helped that piece. We need to keep working on it. The networks are now established. We're all communicating with each other on a fairly regular basis. So we're all cited on any issues that there might be that we can raise with each other. But for me, the absolute key is having that public confidence for people to report incidents to us, that every single one of them will be taken completely seriously, will be investigated thoroughly. And more importantly, what we did also issue was a what to expect document for those people who were reticent about reporting to Police Scotland in the first place, put their mind at rest about what would happen in relation to their reporting an incident to us in the first place. And that has been widely disseminated. So hopefully that should make a real difference as well for those individuals who are maybe a bit fearful of reporting in the first instance.
I do. There was a comment earlier from I think it was Ellen about reporting. Someone who has had as a victim, someone who's had this perpetrated upon them, how would they normally be reporting? Would they go to hospital? Would they go to the venue? Would they? What's the normal? What's the typical reporting journey, as it were?
So I suppose it depends on the individual convener and what they wish to do themselves. Obviously, we have the bystander awareness training that we have been sharing with licensed premises staff, which encourages them to look out for signs of where any person is in distress. So the person could report to somebody within the licensed premise. They could report to Scottish Ambulance Service. They could report to their local A&E, or they could report via 101 or 999 to the police. So there's various ways in which they report that. And for me, the key is making sure that those communications then come back to Police Scotland so that we are cited on if the victim, the individual is in agreement, that we will then become involved and then provide that wraparound for those individuals and help to signpost them as well with regards to further assistance should it be required.
Martha.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a quick point because I think that one of the key issues in this whole conversation is the fact that there is so much there's such a lack of clarity on the procedure for reporting spikings. I think that that goes back to education of, you know, the culture of this whole, you know, the all of these incidents. But mainly, I, as a student, as someone who this could very well happen to, and I know a lot of people who this has happened to, nobody really knows the exact procedure. There is no clear-cut procedure, and I think that is one of the fundamental issues. Because, you know, if that isn't being widely publicized as something that should be done afterwards, then people won't do it. It's already something, it's already a trauma that they have experienced, and so that they're maybe not completely motivated to then, you know, do all of this research to find the specific thing that they have to do afterwards. So I think that, yeah, something that should be a focus from here on out is establishing a clear procedure of who to go to and where to go to. And I'm sure that there is one, but I think it just needs to be, you know, more integrated into the education surrounding this topic.
Well, I think it's up then we turn to Jill Stevenson from the University of Stirling and Director of Association of Managers of Student Services and Higher Education. Jill.
Thanks. Yeah, hopefully I can pick up on some of those points. Notwithstanding the really valid points that have already been made today about this not just being a student issue, but a wider societal issue, I just obviously want to reassure the committee how seriously universities take this. And other than prevention, which I think we can talk about more, our primary focus is really on encouraging students to come forward if they have been a victim of any type of gender-based violence, but including spiking, encouraging those reports and ensure that we're supporting them effectively. So on reporting, I can advise that almost all universities now have been really increasing their efforts in introducing reporting systems, centralised reporting systems, to encourage people to come forward with reports. And those can be either named reports or anonymous reports that will then be dealt with centrally. We have also almost, I think all of us again, if not all, have trained up staff who can then take those reports and are trained in disclosures. So some of the institutions have what you would call SVMLOs or SVLOs, and they're sexual violence liaison officers that are trained to take these reports. So their role is then to work with people that would come forward with disclosures and basically ascertain what support they need. So that could be, you know, people may want to report formally to the university or to the police indeed, or they may just want support such as counselling or emotional support. So that's what we've been investing in to help respond to those reports, as well as investing in the reporting systems that I mentioned. There's also been a lot of training on first responders as well. So whilst our SVLOs are more trained in dealing with disclosures, we understand that a report of this type could come into anybody in the university. It could be a personal tutor, somebody in accommodation, it could be a cleaner, for example. So we're investing again also in training to help staff understand where they would direct students to if they disclose something like this, so they could get support. On communication awareness raising, I think it's been really important for us to, because of the transient populations we have and all the valid points that have been made about concerns about reporting, there's been a lot of work put in to try and encourage students to feel comfortable with coming forward. So the points that have already been made about not using victim blaming, sentiments, but really encouraging support. So you'll see examples of those campaigns at pre-entry, welcome and induction programmes in university to really get this into people's minds early on in their student journey and then throughout as well. And I think Hilary's point is right about communicating with perpetrators, that this is their fault, their responsibility, and this won't be tolerated in universities and wider society. But I do think there is that important message to victims as well about you will be believed, you will be supported, so please do come forward. And I do think there's some good examples of that actually during the pandemic as well, not just about spiking, but examples of messages that went out to students to say, look, if you have been, you know, maybe socialising when you shouldn't have been, for example, during the pandemic, don't let that be a barrier to come forward. You know, you won't be judged for that. You will be supported. So the same sort of messaging is now going out for spiking as well. I know we need to get on. I think I mean, we might touch on some of this later, but one final point I want to really make is that universities are part of a real partnership approach to this, and the importance of partnership is vital. We are an important cog in the wheel, but you know the partnership approach across cities is important. And again, I can talk more about examples of really good partnerships that are in place with police, with the nighttime economy, who clearly have a role here.
Martha mentioned, Jill, that you know young people have been locked in, locked down. And you know that was one of the reasons that she gave, which I think is very plausible, to this uptick we saw. I mean, there was also a comment from Ellen, I think, about the endemic nature of gender-based violence. Has there been an uptick across the board in relation to reported incidences of gender-based or sex-based violence?
Again, it's such a complex question because you know there are all types, and I would probably defer to the police on prevalence across that. But we know with all types of gender-based violence that is underreported, you know, across society. Mm. Our focus, as I say, in universities is trying to encourage people to come forward. And yes, there'll be, since people have brought reporting systems in, you know, they will be seeing increases, but I would say that's a really positive thing for us to see people, you know, more people coming forward. But it is variable depending on the type of offence and type of systems that are in place. But I agree with the points about underreporting, you know, across society. And as I say, defer to Police Scotland for more on that.
Hilary, would you like to make a quick comment on that? And then I'm going to bring in CoCab Stuart, who's got a point about that might be addressed to Mike and Andrew. Hilary.
Yeah, yes, convener, thank you. Probably what I would say is that the confidence in people to report incidents to us, whether it's gender-based violence or any other crime, is absolutely key for us. We want people to come forward, report instances to us. I know there was discussion there about a wee bit of confusion around how the incident should be reported. Police Scotland wants to hear from anybody who is the victim of any crime. And that's really important to get across here, that we want to hear from these individuals. And I think that, you know, that public confidence is absolutely key, and working in collaboration with the partners is absolutely key to increase that public confidence, to give people the courage to report incidents, and then for us to provide that support, that victim-centred support to them as we undertake the investigation.
And maybe I just ask you directly again for clarity, at least from my understanding, when you describe the uptick we saw in October around freshers and in spiking, was that in line with a trend in relation to the general gender-based violence, gender-based victim?
I wouldn't be able to comment on whether that has been an increase generally with gender-based violence, but what I said previously was that spiking incidents traditionally increase round about Freshers' Week. So that spike at that time of the year is familiar to us. The volume was more than in previous years.
Yeah, dramatically so, in fact. Yeah. CoCab.
Thank you, convener. I just wanted to bring in Andrew Green here. I thought it was important to get the perspective from the pub sort of, you know, and the licensed trades. I'm particularly interested in their perspectives on this, but also regarding staff training and how the bystander sort of model is working. Andrew.
Hi, thank you very much. Yes, so both myself and Mike here sort of representing trade bodies, so we probably have very similar perspectives on this. Just to really confirm from our perspective, you know, we encourage our membership and the pubs that is covered in our membership that these are serious events that should be taken seriously when they are reported to staff. That alert and well-trained staff are key within this to detect the signs, the behaviour, and when people are falling ill, what they should be doing about that. So they should have safeguarding procedures as part of their wider framework for looking after their customers anyway. But we encourage them always to take reports to staff seriously. That they should activate their safeguarding procedures when they are reported. So whether that's looking after the health of the customer or making sure that they have got their friends with them, or that if they want the police are called. But then also making sure that they're accurately recording and logging these events so that there is some sort of evidence or trail if the police do become involved at a later date, and possibly also for any internal procedures so that they can improve their own activities for later, for looking after customers. So it's taken extremely seriously, but it also falls within a wider remit of general welfare and safeguarding of customers. So, you're right, sort of, alertness of staff and well-trained staff are a key element in that. Whether it's understanding that, you know, to look out for the signs in customers, to look out for the signs in the behaviour of other customers towards them, friends within groups, and also appreciating that that spiking is a criminal offence. And as was mentioned earlier, that includes alcohol spiking. Extra measures of alcohol is a criminal offence. So staff need to understand that, so that if they're aware that's going on, they stop that. And that messaging is key across.
Sorry, it's difficult with the virtual thing, it overlaps a little bit. Apologies for that. I'm happy if Mike wants to come in as well, if he's got anything to add. So you keep records, so there is a trail, which is great. Can you give me an indication of, has there been an increase of your record keeping? Not, I mean, you keep records, I meant numbers, sorry for the clumsy wording there.
So maybe I should clarify that we would recommend that venues should do that as part of their procedure. They should record that. So whether a venue does or doesn't is entirely down to them. And maybe this harks back a little bit to some of the points that were made earlier about consistency, how these things are recorded, what should be recorded. So some sort of consistent framework, I suppose, would be essential. Otherwise, it's largely up to the venue what details they're taking, and they would probably be doing that from prior experience and their involvement with the police as to what evidence is useful. So, you know, when it happened, who they think was involved, potentially was there any CCTV footage, you know, available, those sorts of details. But anecdotally, if I go back to was I noticing any increase? No, I'd go back to the superintendent's comments that, you know, spiking per se, you know, you see an increase in reported events around about Freshers Week every year, but otherwise we weren't hearing from our members of any extra concerns this year over and above what they had in the past. But obviously it's a very serious thing and should be taken account of. But were we noticing anything over and above? I'd have to say, from what we were hearing from members, no, we weren't. But equally, that's not an official poll. That's not measurement. That's just an anecdotal.
So I'm just interested in taking you back. You were saying that it's good practice to keep records, but actually there is no compulsion and there's no expectation. So what do you think would be the opinion of the industry if there was that idea to bring in some kind of enforcement that venues do have to keep records? What do you think they might feel about that?
I think they want to know what was driving it. So I think we talked right at the start about consistency of reporting. I mean, I think something that underpins all of this is that we perhaps don't have a very accurate sense of what is the prevalence of this. So I think the adoption of any legislative or mandatory requirement, I think, has to be underpinned by some sort of solid evidence as to why that's coming in. So we'd want to be happy that justified any framework coming in. But I suppose I don't think you should be looking at spiking in isolation. If you're going to bring something in, then there are other welfare and safeguarding incidents that might occur in a venue that you should be recording as well. And therefore, any framework you're going to adopt should arguably be wider than just thinking about drink spiking.
Yeah, that's an important point to make if we're looking at gender-based violence as well as that. Mike, did you want to come in there?
Yes, thanks very much, and good morning, everyone. I just to add a little bit of context to what Andrew's saying. Obviously, primarily my organisation represents the late night side of the hospitality sector, and of course, for us, there's different things at play here. But I think it's worth mentioning that when we're talking about the incident recording procedures for late night venues, it is a mandatory thing. It's a condition of licence that all incidents of any sort are reported, and our members are very, very familiar with those procedures. Our staff are very familiar with those procedures. And used in conjunction with CCTV, it does in fact provide a pretty robust system for checking back over any kind of incident that may have happened either on the premises or outdoors at the premises, because very often incidents of one sort or another will happen outside of a premises, which technically would not necessarily be the responsibility of the premises, but by and large premises take these responsibilities or take the duty of care very, very seriously. In terms of training, again, the late night economy has been at the forefront of training initiatives, working with various groups over the years on bystander training, both in engagement with Police Scotland and with other organisations. This is an issue that has and will continue to be taken very seriously. So that's just for a little bit of further context from a late night economy perspective. I agree with an awful lot of the comments that others have made here. I agree that this is not a problem that's unique to the student community, but I think there is there's a clear correlation between Freshers Week and an upsurge in reporting of spiking. And some of us in this roundtable have been involved in ongoing roundtable discussions with the police and with Scottish Government and other bodies on this. One thing that I would say in terms of the upsurge that happened around Halloween, and we did see reporting of it from members that people had made representations that there had been spiking incidents, and the police obviously, have that information to hand too. One thing I think is relevant to that is actually the fact, the point was made earlier in relation to people being locked down for a couple of years. One thing that I think is very key to that upsurge is that, in fact, there was no Freshers Week in 2020. So 2021, in effect, was a double whammy. And we see that in our industry, not just in relation to spiking, but in relation to all sorts of behaviours within, the late night economy and the activities that students undertake. I mean, there's a clear kind of pathway from leaving school through university or college, coming into the big, bad, wider world, going out with friends, all the stuff that we all know that people do. And a lot of the learnings that young people take is peer learning. And the 2020 intake of students didn't have the opportunity for that peer learning because there was no Freshers Week. So I think, you know, I'm just trying to illustrate a point here that I think that that definitely, in my opinion, contributed to this upsurge in incidents, and certainly in reported incidents around the Halloween period. So I think in many respects, I think it's a very positive thing, actually, that this has been drawn into the public consciousness in the way that it has. I think it's presented difficulties for a lot of people, particularly in our industry, but it's also drawn attention to it, and it's caused various groups, including the people around this table today, to take seriously some of the actions that are required. And just finally, I'd go back to the procedures around it, and for me, the consistency in how the reporting of these incidents happens is a key thing, and you know, the protocols around that. And the Chief Superintendent said, Hilary said that, you know, that they would always encourage people to report to the police, and that's quite correct. But we do have reporting to venues, we have reporting to the ambulance service, we have reporting to student services, we have reporting to the police. And you know, I think there needs to be clear pathways for victims or people who suspect they're victims to report this type of incident in a way that can be measured, that can be tracked. And you know, that's not ignoring the difficulties in that, because there are real difficulties. Testing, for instance, is not a straightforward, simple thing. You know, many of the substances or most of the substances that are believed to be involved in these incidents can't be traced in the bloodstream after 24 hours. So, and then there's this conflict about the needle spiking thing, where many experts have said that it's actually impossible to inject somebody with a needle with the sufficient quantities of the type of substances that can actually cause these effects. There's still a great deal of uncertainty about what's really going on here. What I would encourage Scottish Government to do, if I can be so bold, is to look to introduce protocols that are clear and simple for venues, for student services, for students themselves, and for others within the communities, without alarming people about it, but make clear what those pathways are. And I think the final thing I'd like to say is just on the training issue, that the consistency in training is vital. And at the moment, there's not a plethora of training agencies out there who can help with bystander training, for instance. It's left to venues to try and to try and locate those kind of services themselves, and to you know bring that in for their employees. And I think there should be a more concerted approach to that, where again, there's kind of easy access points encouraged and supported by government to allow that to happen. So sorry, that was a big kind of long ramble, but I sat and waited to hear a lot of the other points first. So I've got all that up. Right.
Thank you,
Ravina.
Thank you.
And I just think your comments about needle spiking. Have you seen any evidence whatsoever of needle spiking across all the different businesses that you represent? Is anyone coming forward to say they've seen there's any evidence of needle spiking at all?
Well, we've had reports that some people have reported needle spiking. It's nothing like as prevalent as was
in the venues that your association
around Halloween. I know of a handful of venues where there were reports of needles spiking, and in each of those occasions the police have investigated it, and in each of those occasions they've found absolutely no evidence of it. So there is nothing. I would hope that a police superintendent can back that up, but to my knowledge, there has been no confirmed or affirmed incident of a needle spiking situation within Scotland during that period.
And I'm going to bring in Willie Rennie in a second. Mike, just Well, another couple of questions for you and Andrew, really, and that is the issue of training. You mentioned the training, your staff training. What, just help me understand, what are they looking for? And if they see it, how do they intervene? And what happens if their intervention has no effect? What do they do? Can you just talk me through that?
Well, I mean, staff are trained generally. I mean, again, I'm only really talking for the late night economy, but our staff are trained to watch out for all sorts of behaviours, and you know, responsible premises try and, you know, keep potential perpetrators out of their premises as much as possible. So, you know, that front line of the SES badged stewards is a vital component in this. Staff within the venue, staff on the bar, are trained to watch out for anybody, you know, who may be, for instance, and I agree that drink spiking is probably the most prevalent, well, almost certainly the most prevalent form of it. They're trained to watch out for people double loading drinks. They're trained to watch out for, so for instance, if let's just say for the sake of argument, I went to the bar and ordered a drink for myself and a triple vodka for my companion, then that's an alarm bell. You know, if somebody orders half a dozen shots of a spirit, then somebody, you know, our staff would be trained to gauge where those drinks are going for, you know, once they leave the bar. So they're not just, you know, willy-nilly going, oh great, there's somebody, you know, there's a guy, that's the third time he's been up and ordered six shots of tequila, I wonder what's going on there. It's that type of thing, and you know, staff are very aware of that, and of course that can't be taken to be universal, but it's certainly what's encouraged by our association, it's certainly what's encouraged by responsible operators. And
what would they do? What would they do, Mike? But what do they do after they've noted that this is, there's something suspicious going on in relation to the pattern of buying shots or whatever?
First port of call would be to report, depending on the seniority, I suppose, would be to report either to the charge hand on the bar or to the manager of the venue, depending who was you know, most local to whatever was going on. The manager would then speak with the head steward. Stewards would monitor, you know, the people that have been identified, and just generally keep an eye on the situation. As I say, this is something that our staff do all the time. I mean, you know, they are watching all the time for any signs of, you know, inappropriate behaviour of any sort. I think it's important to note that, you know, from a venue perspective, anything that becomes a problem for the venue. You know, it's you know, quite apart from looking after the safety of the individual, which is our primary concern at all times, the you know, nobody actually needs to end up in a situation where three out of their six stewards are you know, effectively taken out of the game for 45 minutes waiting for an ambulance to arrive, which is what happens. So, you know, it puts pressures on from all sorts of sides. So generally speaking, in late night venues, things are pretty well-oiled kind of machine. Things are run in that kind of way. And I think that, you know, I'm very confident in saying that the vast majority of late night operators have those sort of protocols in place.
And what a typical venue would have a pretty open communication channel with the police on duty in the locality that the venue is situated, yes.
Absolutely. You know, I mean, most venues of the type I'm describing, you know, all the stewards are in radio communication with each other and with the venue manager. And generally speaking, someone, that charge hand on the bar, would also have a radio link to the stewards and to the manager. So these things happen quite quickly. And from there, the communication with the police, the manager generally, or one of the door stewards would simply use a mobile phone to do a 911, or just attract attention, depending on the location, if there's police about on the street. You know, that would be the other way that would happen. But there's pretty straightforward communication levels. What can be an issue is attendance times. with the police, because obviously, you know, similar to as I described with stewards within a venue, police are occupied with one incident that, or, you know, in one part of a city centre, for instance, it can be difficult for the police to attend as quickly as they would like or as we would like. And the same goes for ambulance services.
Yeah, there's an ancillary issue of the availability of first responders across the board in terms of blue light, and that is a point well made. Willie Rennie, he's been very patiently waiting to jump into the conversation.
No, at all. It's fascinating. What's coming through very clear is that actually the bigger threat, and it's present and it's been present for a long time, is the use of alcohol, applying alcohol into their victims in order to gain control. Is there a danger that the recent publicity over drugs spiking with a needle or in the drink is actually giving an unfair or an incorrect focus on that, when actually what we want people to do is to be alert to the traditional drink spiking with, you know, extra alcohol, triple shots and so on? And I suppose the second question is, and this is maybe to the students and victim support and others, are the pubs and venues sort of uniformly, I wouldn't think it's uniformly, but are they meeting Mike's standard that he set out about what you expect from the staff in order to deal with that? And if not, how do we change it? I don't know who wants to go first. Perhaps, I don't know, Kate, perhaps, do you want to go first? Because I think you were the first to raise the whole alcohol triple shots issue.
Yeah, thank you. I think it's about understanding it all, which is why I mentioned the alcohol point and having an understanding about spiking across the board. One of the things that I just wanted to do as well was clarify the legal situation in Scotland, because it's different than England. And Andrew Green talked about a crime. The crime in Scotland, there's two, but one of them is about administering a substance for sexual purposes, and then the other crime in Scotland is drugging. So it's different. The legal position is different in Scotland. There is no specific, as I said earlier on, crime of spiking per se if it doesn't fall into either of those two categories. I don't think it's an either or, as I've said before, Willie. I think it's been alert and aware of all of it. And I agree with some of the comments that have been made, as I said earlier on, around reporting and referral pathways. And I think we have to get to a position where we've got a trauma-informed response across a number of different organisations, where people are given choice and control about who it is that they want to report to and when, and that everybody's clear about that, so that we've got a no wrong door approach on this would be what I would want to see. And certainly, as Hilary said earlier on, we're making moves towards that, but I don't think that we're there yet. And I think, unfortunately, the conversation that we've just had around injection spiking is not helpful from a victim's or potential victim's point of view. We spent a lot of time this morning talking about moving away from victim blaming, but I think we need to be really careful about how that message comes across to people who fear that they may be dismissed, who are not quite sure what's happened to them, and where, as someone said earlier on, some of these substances leave people's system really quite quickly. So hearing a message that there is absolutely no evidence to support a claim is not the same as saying that this has not happened and nor will it ever happen. And I think we need to just be really careful about our communications and our messages around that, so that we truly are encouraging people to come forward to report. We've got really effective support in place for people from a number of different places, depending on the choices that they have. And that everybody's clear on what the next step should be. And I go back to my point about people being able to access testing and screening, potentially without at that point reporting to the police, because I think that's really important. So that's what I wanted to say. A trauma-informed approach to this across the board is what's coming out for me this morning about something that we've made some headway into, but we've still got quite a bit of work to do together on it. Your question about pubs and venues, I think there's probably others on this that are better placed to respond to that than I am. The feedback that we get is that it's patchy. But others may be able to give you really some more detail on that.
Okay, I just take them in order. Maybe Sally Mapstone.
Thank you, Willie. Kate has made a lot of the points that I wanted to make, but I just want to add in a couple here. There is quite a lot of evidence that the victims of spiking are dominantly women. And that's a point we haven't, I think, explicitly acknowledged today. It explains some of the association of spiking with gender-based violence. And again, that's something that we need to take on board, because that is one of the broader contexts in which it's necessary to consider spiking. But I do want to get back to the point that you were also looking at, Willie, that because of the association with gender-based violence, we often associate spiking with malice and with assault. But spiking can also take place, as a number of colleagues have said today, in an attempt, a misguided attempt, to bolster a good night out. And that is where the education side of this is so incredibly important, that we build a cultural awareness that that kind of thing isn't fun and risks you actually coming into the zone of being accused of a crime. I think Kate's quite right to keep mentioning and raising the issue of spiking in the criminal context in Scotland, which is not that clear and really comes in under other types of crime rather than being a notifiable offence in its own right. And I think that's something that would merit some further inquiry. And just one other point, just to build on what a couple of colleagues have said, what students feedback to us is that when they're trying to build this culture of support, they're increasingly finding out that students will say that they would like to have testing available and testing strips available. This sounds very simple, and it sounds like a sort of nice solution or a way of engaging with this problem. But actually, the whole testing strip culture is a complicated one. Some tests only test for one drug, which may not be a particularly, if you like, relevant drug in a particular community. Some test for a variety, but are not widely available. And they're actually quite expensive within the student community. So in my own institution, we have, if you like, stockpiled some testing kits, but we're not just handing them out readily because they're actually quite expensive. You know, it's about 40p a strip. You can get them in batches of 15. But actually, if they're being administered via a students' association, that can add up to quite an expensive bill. So again, when we're really trying to kind of build the culture here of protection and prevention, these are some of the things that we're going to need to get into also from the resourcing perspective.
Okay, thank you, Sally. Jill Stevenson.
Thank you. A couple of quick observations on points, and then maybe a more substantive point about bystander training. One of my observations was there was a point made about, you know, incidents have increased during Freshers Week. And I just wanted to sort of give my perspective that victims, of course, then maybe students, but not necessarily perpetrators. I think that we could be looking at potentially predators seeing opportunities with that population, and also Sally's point there about actually it could be something else altogether. There was also a point made about, because it wasn't a Freshers Week during the pandemic, that there was maybe not an opportunity for the education, you know, to be going out to students. And I just wanted to come back on that to say actually it was quite the opposite, and actually universities were really investing in communications, messaging and training around this in an online capacity and have really strengthened online programmes. And as I said before, work that's gone into induction and welcome as well. So I think just to reassure about the work that's been done in that, definitely took an alternative approach to that during the pandemic, and indeed we'll be working on a more of a blended approach going forward. But to my point about bystander intervention and training, I think it's a point Stephanie raised earlier actually in the chat about training and protocols for young people, because as well as being potentially victims or perpetrators, of course most people can be bystanders. It is an area that universities and colleges have been investing in as part of training. Some have, you know, done a lot of training on things like consent and these areas as well. But I think you find one of the most common areas of training is around the bystander approach for GBV more widely. A point that's maybe not been raised yet is that there is the equally safe in universities and colleges core leadership group which is a group that is working on the, and has just developed actually, the new joint strategy for preventing and tackling gender-based violence in universities. And we're now identifying the priorities for the coming year with a range of partners, some of who are represented here today. So that's a place, I think, where if we're looking at the priorities around training, that's in that strategy and can be rolled out across universities. Training courses also needed in the licensed premises. I keep going back to that, and it's not just universities. And I think Mike had made a point about, you know, where are the providers for that, and can they be sought? And, you know, universities could be helpful, and the gender-based violence and violence against women's sector have obviously been engaging with a lot of providers on bystander training. So there are a suite of providers that could be utilised in that regard. Just, I think, then echoing Sally's point, then we haven't mentioned resources yet, but clearly is a resource-intensive area. I mean, you look at universities, and they're very comprehensive and transient populations. We're very committed to the training and to the support that needs to be put in place. But it is there's a cycle of students coming in. And Sally mentioned the point about testing and student unions as well, and also student unions invest in training too. So it is a resource-intensive area. I think it's something that would be useful to continue to discuss. The only significant investment from Scottish Government in preventing and tackling gender-based violence in universities and colleges was around about back in 2016 with the development of the Equally Safe Toolkit at the University of Strathclyde. And, you know, as I say, the approach now is to have this Equally Safe leadership group. So discussions about the resourcing will be important, and how do we prioritise that to focus on the actions that are going to make the greatest impact across the sector and in wider society.
Okay, and I think lastly, Mike.
Yeah, I just wanted to add something that I hadn't said earlier about there's a perception that there's a need for mandatory searching on entry to late night premises. And I just wanted to make clear, as I've said in the chat, that in actual fact, it's a condition of licence that patrons are searched on the way in. Just to respond very quickly to what Kate said, just on the needle biking issue, there's absolutely no sense that I would be, certainly anyone within our industry, the victim blaming thing is a serious concern. I completely agree with you, and I'm not suggesting for one minute that anyone who suspects that they have been the victim of needle spiking shouldn't report it. I was simply responding to Mr. Rennie's question that had we seen reports of this? And I can only answer that question honestly, and the honest answer was that we have had a small number of reports of it, but none of them have been substantiated. So that, I'm merely stating the facts as we know them. And just lastly, on Jill's point about the freshers situation, the point I was really making, Jill, on that was not that universities or students' associations or anyone else was negligent in any way in terms of the advice that they were making available to students. What I was referring to was the student-to-student peer learning that is a natural part of the student journey, and I think that's what was missed. I wasn't for one second suggesting that universities had been in any way lax. I have a student, a son myself, who was part of that 2020 intake, so I understand the issues around it personally, quite apart from professionally.
Okay, thanks, convener.
Oh, just to continue this theme, specifically with Martha. Martha, you've, as part of the Girls' Night In campaign, you've been boycotting bars and clubs. Is that a general boycott, or is that specific? And just maybe you could explain why that was felt to be the most, you know, the direct action that your campaign wanted to take, Martha. And maybe we get Ellen to comment on that as well, because we haven't heard from Ellen for a while. Want to make sure that we hear her voice, Martha.
Yeah, basically, towards the middle of October, when all of the incidents were really escalating, we felt, you know, when I say we, I mean my student community, felt as though nobody was taking the allegations seriously. And specifically, nightclubs weren't, to our knowledge, doing anything to make reforms. in the way that they were handling the situation and the safety of their patrons. And so in order to kind of gain attention, we decided to organize a one-night boycott of all nightclubs to really, you know, get their attention. And in the process of building up to that boycott, the Girls Netting campaign gained a lot of traction and a lot of attention. And, you know, the discussion was really started, and we all started to have this conversation about things that we can do to tackle these spiking incidents. And so the way that we communicated with nightclubs, instead of just boycotting them with no productive solution, was I gathered kind of data and suggestions from all of the followers and the supporters about things that nightclubs can implement to make their patrons feel safe in the environments that they're facilitating. And in an open letter, which I sent out to as many establishments in Edinburgh, which is where I'm based, that I could think of, I detailed all of the things that, you know, my peers and everyone really who had experience in, you know, the nightclub industry in Edinburgh wanted to see these nightclubs enforcing in their establishments. And so it was a one-night boycott, just to kind of get the conversation going, and I think that was achieved.
What response did you get to your letter, your open letter?
So I just sent it to establishments, and some of them responded, and some of them released statements of their own, you know, disclosing what they were going to implement. So we felt that there was some productive collaboration. Some nightclubs in Edinburgh did not respond, and to my knowledge have not made any productive implementations since the increase in spiking. So it was a varied response. And also, you know, you never know to what extent these establishments are taking performative action to make sure that they don't lose business. But I think that we did see some change in the culture of nightclubs. And as someone who has attended nightclubs since then, I can say that I have seen some productive change.
What are those changes?
I would say increased staff attention is one that has definitely made me feel more safe. Just feeling as though there are people who are watching out for your safety when you're not necessarily, you know, in your complete state of awareness in these environments does, you know, make me feel as though that is something that can prevent these incidents from happening, because not only do you feel safer as a patron, but you would hope that perpetrators then are more hesitant to commit these acts because they know that they're being watched and there is that attention to these possibilities. And additionally, I think that the issue of increased security is one that's quite controversial. I've seen that it's become quite a controversial debate from, you know, within my platform, because you don't want to give too much power to people who will abuse their power to act on their prejudices or their biases. But at the same time, it is something that's incredibly important to make sure that, again, these perpetrators are aware that they can't be bringing these substances, drugs, needles maybe, into these establishments. So I think security is something that needs to be discussed. And yeah, we've seen a lot of creative responses, lids on drinks, things, you know, things that have been implemented to specifically focus on drink spiking. But I think the general consensus was just that there needs to be a high level of diligence in the staff and what they are doing to make sure that everyone who is in their establishments feels safe.
So you think that what you've heard from Andrew and Mike this morning reinforces your confidence that the industry's taking this seriously?
I definitely do. I think that from, like, on a higher level, the authorities is acting with diligence, but I think that it just needs to be monitored more on the level of nightclub leadership. So I don't doubt that there are all these implementations in check to make sure that these processes are happening, but I think that some establishments are just not necessarily up to the standard that they need to be.
Ellen, would you like to add?
Yes, please, Convener. I think, again, speaking specifically around Edinburgh, because that's the place I know best, within online forums and just talking amongst friends, students are aware of nightclubs which feel more dodgy, and where there seems to be a collection of nightclubs, not that they're linked, but ones in which students are more wary and cautious of going to because of the cultural perception that they don't take things as seriously, or there are a number of incidences that have occurred there, and there don't seem to have been very dramatic changes in acknowledging or addressing that. Edinburgh University Students Association has its own club night, and I am really grateful that we haven't had any reported instances of spiking within our own venue. We've done, but in acknowledgement of kind of the kind of increase in cases and students and young people feeling more uncertain and unsafe about being in nightclub spaces, we've done some of the things that Martha's already mentioned, much like kind of things that we've already heard. We've included those. We make sure that people know that our attendees know that there is a well-being space for them, in which if they are feeling unwell or just need some support, they can receive that directly within our venue. We can even offer them safe transport home, and I suppose that is part of being a student association, which we can offer that service to. But our security won't just expel you from the venue because you seem intoxicated. They'll make sure that you are feeling okay, and that you are safe and able to actually make your way home safely also. Our attendees can also access free water from tamper-free dispensers from our staff as well. And also, attendees require a ticket which is linked to their student account also. So again, that's something that is that we have available to us as a students association to make sure that we kind of know who have been in our spaces and can kind of protect them also. I'm particularly interested also to hear about what support is available to those who have already experienced spiking. I think we're talking a lot about prevention in the future and what we can continue doing, but how can we support those who have already experienced spiking and have already experienced gender-based violence through spiking? How can we make sure that they still feel supported, their mental health and well-being is still supported, especially if they're a member of a university or just a young person's community? How do we make sure that they still feel able to enjoy the city and the campus that they're part of? I don't have any answers there, but I'd be really keen to hear.
Well, let's not lose that point. And I think I can see that Kate wants to come back in, but before I bring Kate in, I'm going to bring in Stephanie, who wants to come in. And before we hear from Stephanie, Ellen, the role of social media, you discussed the reputations of certain venues. How do you assess the impact of social media on this whole subject, and specifically around the issue of reputation?
Well, I think social media can have a huge influence on reputation and people's perceptions. You can know so much about a nightclub without even attending it through social media and reading things on public forums, especially if they're kind of pages that are linked to your community, like we have anonymous posting platforms within Edinburgh University through Facebook. So kind of, you know that those are people like you living in the city that you're in. Students do trust what they read. So I think definitely kind of, but it definitely feeds into the nervousness in which people feel around being within the city. I think I have never felt unsafe in the city of Edinburgh until I have started seeing such a mass increase of people's testimonies being publicly shared on social media platforms, which can reach so many people. And I wouldn't want to change that. I want people to know, I would want to know what people are experiencing in the cities and where those areas are, so I can try and keep myself safer. But it is absolutely a fact that I think with the increase of social media testimonies, without a match from local authorities, local nightclubs matching with their own statements and acknowledgement of those issues, people do feel unsafer, and you can feel more cautious walking around in a city that you once loved and felt very safe in.
Stephanie Callahan.
Thank you, Convener. I'm just waiting for my mic on there. So I'm kind of interested in certainly I realise what's been said there about doing something for victims now, and I'm not disagreeing with that at all. But my question was really around, you know, what are the next steps? So we've had the ministerial roundtable, we had police, NHS 24, COSLA, victim support, nighttime industries, rape crisis, other public organisations as well involved in that roundtable there. But I don't see anything down here that speaks about next steps, and particularly with reference to what Mike was saying earlier on about having evidence-based reporting protocols, you know, possibly at a national level there, where there's some information provided for nightclubs that are easy to follow where people are doing similar things. So I'm wondering, you know, is there a kind of a forum or a group in place already? I know we've got Equally Safe in Colleges and their core leadership group, but is there an overarching group that takes into account all these different organisations who are looking at doing a piece of work and sitting down and looking at what perhaps those protocols should be, and also what protocols for bystanders for young people themselves as well? Thanks.
Is that, I think Jill wants to come in on that from what I can see.
Thank you. I was actually going to come in on support, which I might do in a second if that's okay. But on that point, yes, I'd mentioned the Equally Safe core leadership group for colleges and universities. And as I say, that's just put together the strategy and is now working on the annual operational plan for priorities. So certainly reporting protocols, you know, standardising the method, but the consistency and the quality of reporting and the awareness and visibility of reporting is a core priority for that group.
I noticed on the chat, Jill, that you and Mike were having in our chat box, which isn't being broadcast, of course. You're having a discussion. Maybe you could just recap on that. You seem to be in the same space when it comes to this establishing consistent reporting protocols.
Sure. The point I was sort of making there was, given there is the Equally Safe group, and clearly that focuses mainly on the university and college sector, and that is a priority. The point I was just making to Mike, and he's come back to say yes, let's discuss it, is I said I couldn't comment on, you know, maybe four other are in the licensed premises and the nighttime economy on reporting in licensed premises, but clearly we both think there's valuable discussions on, you know, how we link up on that. And as I mentioned, there are really good examples already, I think, of partnerships in some of the cities. There's the two Fearless initiatives in Glasgow and Edinburgh, but also in Stirling. I can say there's the Stirling GBV partnership, where we are liaising between not just the university, but, you know, all the key partners across the city and the nighttime economy on how we might work together.
In answer to Stephanie's point, there are vehicles where this discussion gets carried forward beyond these more public ones.
Yep. All the local authorities will have a violence against women and girls partnership, so or gender-based violence partnership. So that, to me, would be the key forum for citywide approaches or regional approaches to look at this.
I was just going to say, so there isn't something at a national level just now that's kind of overarching then, and is that something that's needed?
Well, as I say, for certainly the university sector, there is because of the Equally Safe group that looks at national, and that feeds into the regional levels as well.
But there's not that overarching multi-agency approach at a national level. Is that something that's missing? Sorry if I wasn't making myself clear there. Apologies.
I think again, I probably need to ask others what for are there. There's obviously Equally Safe Scottish Government strategy, and there is a higher level group there that looks after that strategy, you know, in its widest sense. So there is a forum there, and then the Equally Safe and Colleges falls out of that, and then, as I said, there's the regional ones there. So there is a forum at a more national level looking after that strategy, but will be chaired by Scottish Government or Minister. If it's okay to make a point of support, although you may want to ask more on
that. Please do carry on that, and then bring in Kate.
That's okay, really thank you.
This won't take long on support. We know that some people will come forward to report when this happens immediately, but often people will take a long time to come forward to report for lots of good reasons that have already been addressed. So another area I think that universities particularly are working on is having that support in place. So I mentioned a couple of times the sexual violence liaison officers. They have been, you know, really quite intensively trained, not just on taking disclosures, but on providing that sensitive, trauma-informed approach their role will be to also refer on to other types of support, either in universities or externally. So I can say, for example, that my own university at Stirling, there are partnerships in place with Rape Crisis, Victim Support and Women's Aid, to name a few. And you know, Rape Crisis and Victim Support will also come onto campus to hold clinics so that people can access that. And I know that's common across a number of universities. I just segue slightly into wider support, mental health and counselling support. Again, these two areas are so linked, and this is an area of high priority for universities, as you'll know, investing in mental health and counselling support. All universities have been investing in their mental health strategies and associated staffing around that. Clearly, Scottish Government have also provided some welcome investment in counsellors over the last couple of years in universities, and between the universities' investment and Scottish Government investment, I think that's had some really positive effects on the mental health and wellbeing support for students, where we're starting to see really good reductions in waiting times. So we need to think about how we can continue that funding and those approaches. One point I think is, as we know, NHS and specialist services waiting times are extremely long for mental health support and also for specialist support and sexual violence as well. So again, I reiterate the point, whilst universities are putting a lot of investment and work into this, there's that danger of, I think, them being seen as filling the gaps, you know, in wider services such as NHS and specialist services. And I think it's important we don't lose sight of that.
Thank you. And Kate, in the same vein.
Thank you. Yeah, I suppose I just wanted to come back to the point about an overarching group that was made. Police Scotland have a group that they've been running with partners, but it's not of the same magnitude as the ministerial roundtable. And I guess what you've heard is that there's different sectoral groups involving different partners, but there's not, my understanding is there's not an implementation group, if you like, that's following on from the ministerial roundtable with the type of people involved in it that were involved in that group, because I think that was the first time certainly that we've been involved in as broad a group as that. And I suppose I'd make the point again that thinking through the lens of, you know, not all spiking as was mentioned before is about an intention around sexual assault. Not all of it is happening on universities and college settings. So trying to think of an overarching group that would mean that there's robust and clear pathways around reporting and support, no matter what the avenue and the forum, I think is really important. So I thought that was a helpful point. The point about support that's been made as well, I would echo. I mean, there's a number of organisations ourselves where we support victims of any type of crime, whether it's reported to the police or not. So we're an organisation that's got a very, very broad remit and works across the whole of Scotland. You'll be aware of other organisations who have got more specific areas of focus, for example, Rape Crisis in this space, who will support victims of serious sexual assault. So there are a number of third sector organisations in and around. We've got helplines, we do receive calls on this issue, and we've got local community support that can be put in place. One of the things that kind of concerned me, I suppose, is a conversation in one of the roundtables where, for example, with the ambulance service, I was asking them about their referral mechanisms for people that they have, where they've attended to provide a first response, and what do they do afterwards. And their response to me on that was that they report to they provide information to the police, but they don't actually appear to have a referral protocol in place with other third sector organisations or anyone else to provide emotional support afterwards. So that would be an area of focus that I would like to see developed so that people can be provided with appropriate support at any time. And just on the points that have been made around NHS, mental health services and other specialist support, yes, that is very stretched and that is challenging us all as organisations who are providing emotional support, but not necessarily counselling, for example. So the pandemic and the kind of has not certainly helped with that. The other point I wanted to make around reporting is that the response that people get all the way through the system or the process is really, really, really important. So we're focused a lot on health. We're focused a lot on immediate responses, for example, by venues. But there's also the issue about how the criminal justice system treats people all of the way through. The lack of convictions in this area, the fear around victim blaming, the lack of a feeling of a trauma-informed justice system, quite frankly, does not help within this. Victim support and other organisations are increasingly concerned about the delays within the justice system itself that is that will be putting people off from reporting, and that is a big concern. There has to be a systemic approach around getting this right and tackling this so that people are not put off from coming forward, and also do not drop out as the process progresses. So that's an area, obviously, the criminal justice system that we work in very, very closely, and is an issue that we've been raising in a number of forums with others as well. So just wanted to make that point that as much as there's delays in NHS, the delays in the criminal justice system are absolutely massive just now, and that's not helpful in this area either.
And I think you said some important things there about the devastating impact that this has on the mental health and overall well-being of the victims of these sorts of crimes. I'm going to come back to the whole concept of crime in a minute, but I wanted to bring in Ellen, who wanted to make a comment about health services and in the context of this discussion about support. Ellen.
Thank you very much. I'm sure everyone is aware of how stretched university mental health services are, but I also wanted to share some recent data that Edinburgh University has collected in December 2021 around students' ability to actually even access GP services within the City of Edinburgh, because we've heard testimonial reports of students really struggling. So we were able to survey, I believe, around 2,000 students, 60% of which said they were registered with a GP. They're definitely not nearly as close as we would want it to be. And those who have registered, 13% needed to try 3 to 4 practices to find a practice that would be able to admit them. And of those who aren't registered with a GP in Edinburgh, 42% of them had attempted and not been successful to find a GP. So in terms of students being able to access health services beyond what the university is able to offer and is struggling to offer due to the capacity issue, the lack of availability or capacity within our GP services is posing a huge challenge on young people who live within the city as university students, as we've got the numbers there showing that not nearly enough of them have been able to or are registered with a general practice. I just wanted to share that. Thank you.
That's very useful and very insightful. And I'd also want to bring back in Hilary Sloan, because there's been a number of discussions there about structures, national structures, bringing people together under one roof, as it were. What's your comment on that? I see you've made some comments in the chat box. I think they're useful to get them onto the official record.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. Yeah, just to reiterate that there is a command structure presently in place that's headed by ACC Gary Ritchie. Within that command structure, there is a blue light group, for want of a better term, but sitting below that is the partners group that I mentioned at the start of this meeting. And what I had suggested was in the chat bar that potentially that those networks and relationships that have already been established from a national perspective could be used as the basis for taking this ongoing work forward, to progress some of the issues that have been discussed today. And I've already had that conversation at a previous partners meeting, whereby a lot of the messaging going forward will become business as usual amongst all those parties that are around the table. So I thought it might be a good opportunity to use that structure as a starting point. Thank you.
And that group that you're describing of these stakeholders, does that include everybody or all of the organisations, for example, on this round table?
More or less, yes, it will have. It has student representation, the licensed premises,
various third sector organisations such as Victim Support and Rape Crisis, they are all represented at that meeting.
And I know that Willie Rennie wanted to come back in and guessed in the chat box that things may have moved on, but I don't want to lose the point that Willie Rennie wanted to make, because it's important to get everything on the record. Willie? Ah, he's not at his desk. That's okay. I should have checked with him before I said. We lose Sally at the top of the hour. She's got another commitment. We're grateful for the time we've had with her. But in your opening comments, Sally, you intimated that you would like to say something more at some point about working with young people. And maybe I'd like to have you take the opportunity to do that now, before we lose your presence at the round table.
Thanks very much. I think it's been a really useful discussion today, and I think we've moved the conversation on a lot. Before I revert to that point, I do just want to reiterate the value of using existing structures in engaging with this. There's a lot of expertise around the table. Jill's mentioned the importance of the Equally Safe Group, which obviously the Scottish Government is involved in, and I think drawing on the work of that group, building on it, is really important. But obviously, from a regional and national perspective, the kind of connections that Hilary is suggesting also seem to me to be really important. It just seems to me that, and I go back to that initial point about students and young people being the victims of spiking, and you can make a distinction between the two, which I was keen to do, but it's also important to read right across. And I think a lot of what we're talking about here is consciousness raising about how you lead your life, how you show responsibility and kindness and respect to others. And that's surely general messaging, which is really appropriate to everybody. I think as universities, we certainly already feel, as colleges do, that we have responsibilities that extend way outside our particular sector, and that we can help to model the kinds of behaviours that we want to encourage. So my point was really more in that area, that I think we can take the instance of spiking as an example of something that is unfortunately part of our culture, but one which we all have a responsibility to seek to redress, and that while this is not exclusively a student phenomenon, it's one where we have a responsibility to work out with our sector as well as within it, tackle it. Thanks.
Thank you very much. But Sally, just to roll the discussion forward from that, there's been a lot of discussion this morning about the fitness of our criminal law in relation to the subject matter we're discussing today. What's your view on that? I mean, it's been made clear a couple of times that we don't have a specific crime in statute that deals with this, as it isn't called out specifically. Should there be?
Well, convener, as people always say in these circumstances, I'm not a lawyer, but it does seem to me that it is a bit of a problem that we do not have a specific offence which targets spiking. And if you look at the equivalent legislation in England, which has its own limitations, because again, spiking is badged under the Sexual Offences Act in particular, but we don't, in our legislation, specifically refer to spiking. And I think at the bare minimum, that needs to be looked at, because I think specific references to spiking in legislation really could, again, seek to consciousness raise and actually give us something more to focus on in that context. As to whether and how we should pull out spiking as a specific offence, I think that's worth looking at, yes.
Should be part of some kind of formal review.
Yes, I think so. I think it would be useful to take a serious look at it and see if we need to construct an offence in that way. But surely that's almost a necessary follow-on from this conversation.
Kate, I'd like to turn to you with that same topic. You've already intimated that you have strong feelings about this. Do you want to elaborate on them?
Well, I think I would agree with Sally, and I think if you, the conversation that we've been having around the importance of people feeling confident to report, people feeling confident that they'll be believed, and that there's an appropriate response both within a support system but also within the criminal justice system. I do think that looking at that would be helpful, and making an assessment and looking at other jurisdictions and what they do. So, for example, there was stalking in Scotland has a specific offence now attached to it, and that makes a massive difference for victims and how they perceive how they're going to be believed, how it's going to be taken seriously. And I do think the conviction rate is a cause for concern for people too. So I agree with Sally. I think it should be examined further.
And Martha, your view on that?
Yeah, I definitely agree. I think that, you know, all of those are really important points to be made, and that needs to be definitely an emphasis on, you know, victim blaming being something that is not like a part of our culture anymore. So yeah.
And Ellen, and as you can tell, I'm working my way around the table.
Yeah, I don't feel like I have any additional comments to add to that. I really agree with everything that Kate said in today's roundtable. So thank you, Kate, for all of those comments. I think particularly what struck with me is kind of the discussion and the point that you raised around making sure that we're not dismissing reports of needle spiking or the damage that the media can do in saying that there's absolutely no evidence, and what that can do in terms of young people, women and non-binary and trans folk feeling as if they aren't believed or supported in a bigger and wider system.
Kate, did you want to come back in? I see that you put an R in the chat box. Do you want to come back in?
Yeah, it was just this point about legislation, because I think that the requirement around a sexual intent from an evidential point of view can be quite challenging for the police and the Crown. So I do think that's why it's worth looking at in more detail. And I was going to come back on the point that Hilary made about extending potentially the group that Police Scotland have set up, and just to say that obviously we would be more than happy to continue involvement in that, if to turn that into an implementation type group where we are, and as Sally says, making best use of what other forums are going on and what's been developed in other areas that may well translate well across the piece.
That sounds eminently sensible to me, I have to say. Does anyone else have a view about the need? Would it be helpful if there was a specific crime in law? I mean, I'm looking to the industry in particular. Mike, Andrew, welcome back. By the way, we lost you for a bit there. Would it be helpful to you in the work you're doing, safeguarding in the venues? Would it be useful, Mike?
Sorry, Mike.
Sorry, Andrew. Didn't mean to speak across you there.
I just agree. I think. You know, a specific offence obviously would hopefully raise the confidence of anyone that wants to report this, that it will be taken seriously, and it aids the consistency and accuracy of reporting. So on both levels, I think it would be a bonus to do that, both, and it would certainly aid the industry and the trade to do that.
Yeah, I was just going to say the same thing. And actually, our colleagues south of the border face similar, you know, similar problems. I believe there are three different crime categories in England which cover this issue, and so, you know, they can be reported in the context of different crime categories, which isn't helpful at all. So I think anything that streamlines that and keeps the focus, along with you know, the reporting protocols, I think those two things go hand in hand. And I think when you have that, then it's possible to build up an accurate picture of what's really going on. And for instance, we shed light on the needle spiking issue, which is clearly something that at the moment is very hard to quantify. And nobody, of course, seeks to engage in any kind of victim blaming over this. It's about trying to pull information together so that we can act in concert with the relevant authorities to make sure we're doing everything that we can.
Thank you, Mike. And Jill?
Yeah, on legislation, I think it can't hurt, and clearly it would help in terms of reporting the numbers and getting a better sense of prevalence. But just a word of warning, I suppose, that of course it has to be part of a suite of measures. We know that having legislation in place for other types of sexual offences is not the panacea, and you know the reporting rates are low, and of course conviction rates are low. So yes, it may act as a deterrent to some, and it will have a purpose. But you know, we obviously just can't rely on that, and it's about really increasing confidence reporting, but increasing the conviction rates, most importantly.
And I think it's worth going back to Hilary Sloan, reflecting on what Jill has just said. And what in this specific area of spiking, both needle and drink spiking, what are the barriers to getting convictions? Because it seems to me that one of the things that I've picked up at least is hard to actually get the evidence beyond the reporting. What are the barriers?
So as you say, it's obviously the individuals involved having the confidence to come to the police in the first instance. We have an investigative strategy that has been shared throughout Police Scotland as a whole, and there are various mechanisms within that strategy to look at different how to get information that can potentially lead to a report going to the Procurator Fiscal, and then obviously is getting that case to court. So there are issues in relation to that, but we are really open to be working with partners to try and overcome those barriers. And again, the key for me is making sure that people are confident about reporting the incidents in the first place. Our investigative strategy will then take over, and we will go through all those different inquiries in order to get as much evidence as possible to be able to put perpetrators or offenders to court.
Well, before we conclude our evidence session, I just want to make sure that my colleagues, members of the Scottish Parliament who are on this call, who are on this round table, whether they have anything they wish to add. I was conscious of the fact that Willie Rennie had wanted to come in earlier and we didn't get him in. Willie's there. Do you want to come back in and make the point you were going to make earlier?
I think, Convener, we've broadly moved on. I mean, I think what's clear is there's some excellent practice going on within the various institutions, and many of them are reflected here. What I wasn't clear about was how we're making sure that everybody's applying that best practice. How do we target those that perhaps through no fault of their own need extra help and support, but are oblivious to the support that's available? How do we make that happen to make sure that everybody is like the people that are here today?
Would anyone like to come in on the back of Willie's comment? While you're thinking about it, maybe I can ask Stephanie to come in.
Thanks, Stephen. I'm thinking as well, just in Willie's comment there, possibly through council licensing might be the approach. The question I wanted to ask was, I know we have kind of covered to a degree as well about drugs testing at venues, but I was wondering specifically what Martha and Ellen had to say on that, because I can imagine that, you know, a lot of the under-reporting and a lot of the issues with young people and a lot of the trauma is that feeling of confusion and fear and uncertainty about what's happening, not knowing the kind of ambiguity and feeling quite helpless about the situation, if that might actually help improve reporting of it, as well as maybe helping people actually deal with the trauma itself. But I do realise, you know, it's quite complex and there are practical and financial things to take into account as well. Thanks.
And let's get James Dornan in as well, and then those of you who wish to, yes, we thank Sally for being on the round table. We know that we only had you till 11 o'clock, but so thank you for giving us your time. Maybe I can bring James Dornan in, and then we can get some responses from our round table. James.
Okay, thank you, Stephen. It's just around the issue of legislation. I can see the benefit to it in terms of the message it sends out, the importance we're giving it. But it does seem to me that sometimes what happens is that we do these things for the right reason, and then we create a rod for our own backs. And I worry that this one would be a really, really complex piece of legislation, because where do you draw the line on the spiking? For example, about somebody was saying earlier on that you know, spiking drinks with alcohol is still by far the most common. What happens if you buy your mate a double without his permission? You know, that's where is the line drawn, and how do you target those that need to be targeted? I think that's, you know, one of the difficulties. But although I definitely have supported legislation before, which is about sending out that strong message, and I can see where a strong message could be sent out here, I just worry about the practical difficulties.
Okay, so thank you, James. The first person wants to come back on you on that, I think, is Kate. And Kate.
Yeah, I mean, I think any legislation of what we've got currently is problematic too, I suppose, is the first thing I would say. So I think it's about what, you know, which is most helpful and which is least problematic. I would be pointing towards the stalking offence around unwanted and focusing on that word. And looking to whether that could be applied to spiking. And I think, yeah, there are issues with the legislation that we've currently got in terms of the intention that lies behind it, and that's where looking at something different would be helpful potentially. But yeah, I can't give you a straight off the top of my head easy answer to what would be the most problematic, the least problematic piece of legislation and way it's worded. But certainly from my point of view, I think, as I've said before and others have said, it's definitely worth pursuing, because what we have just now is not. If we had a legislative structure that was without issue, then we wouldn't be asking for it and we wouldn't be discussing it. But I think it needs to be looked at further, and the drafting people will be the best one to come up with how it should be worded, I would have thought.
And Ellen.
Thank you. Just to once again agree with Kate, and I feel like legislation really does legitimise people's experiences and their fears around spiking and their unsafety within some of our spaces within the city. I think also I might have to have Stephanie's question repeated, but I think in terms of people's hesitancy to come forward and report some of these instances comes from a lack of transparency around what the procedure actually looks like, and also that feeling that you will just be giving your report and there's no additional support towards your well-being and your mental health that comes in accompaniment to that very raw and exposing experience in which you might not even be believed and nothing might come of it. So I think in terms of like an individual feeling, you know, just as a playing piece in going through a very emotionally exposing reporting process is definitely something that disincentivizes people coming forwards. I'd really want to emphasise that point around having readily available mental health and wellbeing support for those who do come forward, whichever method they choose to report through. I know I said at the beginning, at the moment it's very unclear to people who they should be reporting to. Is it the police? Is it the nightclub or the venue or the bar? Or is it the university? Is it the Students' Association? Not clear, and that only adds to the barriers in the way of people actually coming forward about this.
Thank you, Ellen. Mike Grieve.
Yeah, just a couple of quick points. One, you know, just in response to Stephanie's question or remark in terms of consistency of the approach within the industry, I think I just wanted to note the point that, you know, the trade bodies represented here, and in fact, you know, they're all slightly different across the licensed trade, but in the case of our own representing the late night economy, this is a, you know, it's a non-funded, it's a members association, so there's no resource there really, no matter how much we might like to roll out a kind of best practice thing beyond the immediacy of our own membership. And I think that the way that that can be improved actually is along the lines of the initiative. Well, Glasgow City Council brought forward an initiative 2.5 years ago, 3 years ago, and incepted a nighttime economy commission with various input from different parts of the sector. And I think having those kind of structures in place would help. I think actually Scotland wide, that would be a very useful thing. And we see in Manchester, for instance, where there's a nighttime economy advisor to Manchester, Greater Manchester Council. And that's been very, very effective in bringing together all the different elements of that, you know, that huge conurbation that actually Greater Manchester is. And that's why I say I think in Scotland, actually, a Scotland-wide body could be a very useful way of bringing forward that type of best practice approach. And if I can just, before I come off here, just respond quickly on the, you know, where do you draw the line with, you know, getting your mate a double sort of thing. I think it's really important to acknowledge that actually getting your mate a double, if he's not asked for it, actually does cross a line. You know, that's why, in my opinion, why there should be legislation around this, because otherwise people will always say, oh, I was just having a laugh or whatever, and it's my mate or whatever. So to me, that addresses the very point. In this day and age, we have to acknowledge that you can't buy other people double the amount of drink that they actually want unless they've asked for it.
Yeah, powerful point. And Bob Doris.
Yeah, thanks. I followed the conversation this morning. It's been absolutely fascinating and very helpful. And it was a supplementary relation to Mr. Dorman's suggestion that reviewing the law on spiking could be challenging, complex. I'm just wondering, from the panel this morning, whether there's a wider benefit reviewing the legislation on spiking, or the lack of legislation on spiking, because it would force government and wider society to yet again review Scotland's relationship with alcohol. It would involve engagement with women's groups, with youth groups, with the licensed sector, with Police Scotland, with wider society in general. So is there a wider intrinsic value of holding a consultation to see what reviewing legislation and spiking would look like, irrespective of the complexities?
Someone want to come in on that? Don't see anyone taking you up on your question, Bob. Kate?
You might, yeah.
You got any?
Yeah, just to say I agree, and that would be one of the benefits. And I also agree with Mike's point that he made around unwanted additional alcohol or substances being given to someone is not something that we should be tolerating in Scotland. And I agree as well with the points made around Scotland's relationship with alcohol and substances. And I think it was part of Sally's point earlier on, wasn't it, about Scotland's definition of a good night out and what can be done to enhance that steps over a line. So yeah, I think it would be useful.
And James Dornan.
Thank you, convener. I just say I want to come back on that point. First of all, I am a non-drinker, right? So I'm not somebody who's going up and buying doubles for my mates. But it does highlight the difficulty in what we're talking about, because you're talking about changing a whole culture for people of a certain generation, if you like, who think they're doing the right thing. But I agree, actually, with everything that's just been said in relation to it, but they're doing the wrong thing. So education has to be there. If there's going to be any legislation, education has to be a massive part of that, if not before it, but certainly as it's coming out, if it does happen.
Yeah, I agree with James on that score, that's for sure. Jill?
Yeah, just to agree with all that's been said in the last few minutes, and there is value in exploring this, but just to reiterate the point I made about it's part of that bigger picture, which I think supports the point that was just made there a moment ago. It's education, and communication and you know, that whole strategy as well as the legislation.
Thank you, and thank you to all of you. I think we've come very naturally to the conclusion of this morning's roundtable. It's really been interesting and really valuable for me to be, you know, speak personally, really valuable to hear each of you talk from your own perspectives about this issue. And what's been really heartening is the degree of unanimity there is about next steps and how different stakeholders can work together. So we will watch on with interest as to what happens next, but I think there's been a lot of stuff here that is greatly encouraging. I'd like to thank Jill Stevenson, Ellen McRae, Martha Williams, Mike Grieve, Superintendent Hilary Sloan, Andrew Green, Sally Mapstone and Kate Wallace for their time this morning. It is very much appreciated by the entire committee. Your contributions have been much valued. The public part of today's meeting is now at an end. I will now suspend the meeting, and can I ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams, which will allow us to further consider the agenda items we have taken in private. Thank you and a very good morning.